This regular meeting of the Judson Board of Trustees is hereby called to order at 7 p.m. I am very pleased that you've taken time to join us this evening. As the Judson Board of Trustees, we are here to set goals and policies and oversee the management of the district. We are responsible for approving budgets, contracts, personnel appointments, and to listen to reports from the superintendent. We are not here to make administrative or management decisions pertaining to the daily operations of the district. This is the responsibility of the superintendent. In compliance with the State Government Code on Open Meetings, tonight's agenda has been appropriately posted. This is a meeting in public, not a meeting of the public. As our guests, you are welcome to observe and listen. These proceedings are being video and audio recorded and will become part of Judson's permanent legal record. In order that the tape adequately reflects these proceedings, please silence your mobile devices and refrain from talking while others are speaking. Since it is legally mandated that these proceedings are recorded accurately, I may have to ask for order periodically should I notice that disruptions are interfering with our recording capabilities. Once again, I extend to each of you a sincere welcome from the entire school board. Thank you for your interest in Judson ISD. We have established a quorum, and I will call roll. Mr. Macias.
Present. Welcome.
Mr. LaFoyle.
Present.
Mr. Flores.
Present. Thanks for
Mr. Salinas.
Present. And thank everybody for taking your time being here with us tonight. Happy Fest.
Ms. Pichon.
Present. And thank you for being here. And I'd also, if I may, Madam President, like to take this opportunity to congratulate Suzanne Knoyer, Mr. Gilbert Flores, and Mr. Arnold Salinas for being the endorsements from San Antonio Express News.
And I am Melinda Salinas. Thanks for being here tonight. And we also have Dr. McGray, our superintendent.
You welcome, folks. We're going to be honoring a lot of great students today.
Thank you. We'll now stand for invocation and Pledge of Allegiance.
Ladies and gentlemen, please bow your heads. Dear Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to come together at a meeting to not only honor our students, but to thank our staff who work with those students, as well as the parents and community people that want to improve our school district and make it better for everyone. It's not easy, but working together as a team, we can accomplish these things through your guidance and assistance. Again, we ask everyone to be safe as we go home after the meeting, and we thank you for everything. We pray to the Lord. Amen.
I'd like to introduce to you our pledge leader for tonight. He is Humberto Aguayo. He is the one of the top students from Eloff Elementary School. And Humberto is an excellent student that makes straight A's and is a perfect example of the excellence among our JISD students. He is a role model for others to follow. Let's join Humberto in the Pledge of Allegiance to the U.S. and Texas flags.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to the Texas, one state, under God, one indivisible.
You may be seated. And let's give Umberto a hand for a nice job. I believe his mama said the same. Can you just raise your hand? Stand up, say this question. I would also like to recognize our color guard for this evening from Wagner High School Junior ROTC, Cadet Staff Sergeant Cameron Watts, Cadet Staff Sergeant DeCivity Oyaka, Cadet Private First Class Carla Cruz, and Cadet First Class Shamari Washington. We do also have some student liaisons. Please stand to be recognized if you are present. From Judson High School, Frona Cuno, Veterans Memorial High School, Abigail Barraza and Amy Barraza, Alyssa Morales. From Wagner High School, Amy Truong, Lee Wallace. From JECA, Mackenzie Pineda. And Judson Early College Academy, Corbin Cadillo and Christian Cadillo. Thank you very much for being here. All right, our board recognitions for this evening start off from Judson High School. The school's Theater Arts Department recently competed in the Texas Forensics Association State Contest in Plano, and one student did exceptionally well. After 2 days of intense competition, Sade Smith won the state competition in the poetry classification, along with a beautiful trophy. She also won a $500 scholarship from the TFA. Congratulations to her and the Judson Theater Arts team for great performances. Their coaches are Larry Bailey and Larissa Bryan. Mr. Bailey has her trophy there as well. And let's say Sally Smith for here. Okay, right there. No doubt about that. All right, thank you. Our second recognition comes from Wagner High School. This group of student athletes hung together and made school history and district history. The Wagner boys basketball team went 36-3 this year. The team won all three tournaments it entered, and they were District 27-6A champs, bi-district champs, area champs, and regional quarterfinal champions. They went on to the regional tournament and beat a good Laredo United team and had a great game against Austin Westlake, where they won in the last seconds of the game to push them to the state tournament. They made school history by winning their first semifinal game and playing in the state final, where they eventually fell short against Sac Falls, but they had a great run. Please congratulate the Wagner boys basketball team members.
Coaches are head coach Rodney Clark and assistants Andre Jackson, Kevin McKiller, and Christian Guerin. Athletic coordinator is Charles Bruce, and the managers Chris Chandler, Clifton Neely, Noah Perez, and Javon Christian. With a basketball team, we're going to have the board members kind of hidden, I think. And with the passion of this, with the passion of this service, go stand up if you're here. Our next recognition is from Johnson High School. The football season is over, but the recognitions for this team continue to come in. This student athlete was selected to the 2016-2017 Subway Super Team. The honor is a partnership between Subway and Dave Campbell's Texas Football, which is one of the longest-running publications of all levels of football in the Lone Star State. Please congratulate this student for his selection to the Subway Super Team, defensive lineman Darren Thomas. This head football coach, of course, is Sean McCullough. And is any are his family members here? Right here, okay. And our next recognition comes from several schools, Keyhawk, Kirby Middle Schools, and Judson High School. The students are from our Skills USA program. These students recently competed at the state conference in Corpus Christi, and we have quite a group that placed at that statewide contest. I'm going to be announcing these school groups, so you might work out better if we hold the applause until each group is finished, but I'll have three schools to announce here. So, first of all, from Judson High School, Crystal Morales, first place in motorcycle gas tank project, Raymond Hayes, first place in motorcycle gas tank, John Melchor, first place in custom paint job, Juan Vasquez, first place in custom paint job, Enrique Lozano, first place in custom paint job as well, Wilmar Ramirez, second place in Batman motorcycle gas tank, and Royal Kimbrough, second place in motorcycle gas tank as well, and their instructor is Mr. Salinas. We also have Manager Hill, first place in Best in Show Award for Individual Project Transmission Overhaul. Christopher Lamont, I may need to be speaking to you a little bit later on about that transmission. Christopher Lamont, second place for Employment Portfolio, and Kevin Flores, second place for Individual Project Starter Overhaul as well. And again, Mr. Salinas was very quick. All right, now, in the middle school category, we have one student from Kirby Middle School that did very well as well, Nicholas Davey, second place construction tool ID contest, and his instructor is Mr. Dean. Now, also from in the middle school category, Keyhawk Middle School. Now, we have several from Keyhawk, be patient with me, please. Aiden Silver, first place construction tool ID contest, first place outdoor kitchen in the job exhibit. Maritza Brunson, second place in the IOTA Lambda Sigma writing contest, first place exploratory opening and closing team. Yonella Bahena, first place barbecue grill, third place automotive tool ID, first place exploratory quiz bowl team, and first place exploratory opening and closing team. Thomas Faulkner, first place barbecue grill, and first place exploratory quiz bowl team. Alexis Gonzalez, first place porch swing, second place automotive tool ID, first place exploratory quiz bowl team, and first place exploratory opening and closing team. Martina Magana, first place porch swing and first place exploratory opening and closing team. Bella Kelly, first place on a picnic table, first place exploratory quiz bowl, and first place exploratory opening and closing.
Taylor Evans, first place fire pit and first place exploratory quiz bowl team. Erica Witt, first place fire pit and first place exploratory opening and closing team. Ryan Marquez, first place fire pit, first place automotive tool ID, first place exploratory quiz bowl, and first place exploratory opening and closing team. And Nicholas Hensley, first place park bench and first place exploratory quiz bowl team. Their instructor is Mr. Aceveda. And while they are taking the picture here, I might also add that the opening and closing team did successfully defend their state title and will return to the national competition this summer in Louisville, Kentucky. And I'll let you know how that turns out. And the parents of these students, can you please either stand or raise your hand? Let us know. All right, and those are our recognitions for this evening. Thank you.
We'll move on to acknowledgement of visitors and citizens to be heard. This time is provided for citizens to address the board on issues or concerns. A person may speak one time for a period of 3 minutes. Presentations shall be informative only. No board action will be taken. A complaint or charge against an officer or employee of the district is not allowed in open session. Complaints and concerns should first be addressed by campus and or district administration. If your topic involves a personnel matter, a student matter, or if you contend that your legal rights have been violated or board policy not followed, we have specific grievance procedures, DGBA, legal and local, for these matters, and now is not the appropriate time to discuss these matters. We respectfully ask that you refrain from making personal attacks or rude or slanderous remarks on, or becoming boisterous. The presiding officer shall determine whether a person who wishes to address the board has attempted to solve a matter administratively. If not, the person shall be directed to the appropriate policy to seek resolution before bringing the matter to the board at a subsequent meeting. Citizens wishing to receive a response from concerns presented to the board must provide written documentation. The board shall not deliberate or decide regarding any subject that is not included on the agenda posted with notice of the meeting. Our first person is Marilyn McKinney regarding pay increase.
Good evening. My name is Marilyn McKinney, and I'm speaking to you this evening as the president of the Justin Education Association. I am here to urge you, strongly urge you, to find the money for a significantly substantial pay increase for your employees in Justin ISD. You want us to produce quality education enabling students to become successful in a global society. That's the format, that's the stage with whom we are competing, not just to produce quality individuals, but to find quality individuals who will come to Judson, work in Judson, and help you fulfill that mission. While you may be competitive within similarly demographic districts, sadly, those districts aren't within Bexar County. You are not significantly competitive in terms of pay with the school districts in your immediate vicinity. Teachers face a lot of grief, no matter what district you're in. But unfortunately, in many other very nearby pastures, it is greener in terms of pay. I would urge you to take a good hard look at the budget and find the money. In
2006. We were spending, as a district, about 80% of the money on personnel. You haven't spent anywhere close to that since 2011. That information comes from your website, which you need to fix. Because if you go to statistics and about us, it's all a hodgepodge now, and you can't click on anything to get this information. You have spent about 62% on payroll since 2011. I have wondered for years where that 20% has gone. It needs to go back to the employees. Quality costs. You're going to have to put your money into what you value. And it's got to be your employees. Thank you.
Next one is Reginald Walker regarding invite to Spring Tag Fair.
Good evening. My name is Reginald Walker. I'm the TAG co-coordinator at Jensen High School. I would like to invite the members of the board and members of the community to the Spring TAG Fair at Jensen High School in the cafeteria on the 25th of April, 6:30 to 7:30. The students were tasked with developing a lesson incorporating all core subjects included in there with supplemental aids. They are very creative and came up with some really great ideas. So please come join us at Jensen High School cafeteria, April 25th, 6:30, 7:30. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have Michael Beaver regarding Randolph Metrocom Rotary. Michael Beaver.
I'm Michael Beaver. I'm the CEO at Northeast Methodist Hospital, and I'm here tonight on behalf of Randolph Metrocom Rotary. Thank you for allowing me the opportunity to address this board. First, I want to let you know that our 20th annual golf tournament, the Fairway for Kids Golf Tournament, raised over $15,000 last fall. As you may recall from previous years, 100% of those proceeds go to the Greater Randolph Area Partners in Education Foundation. 100% of that funding goes to meet financial needs of students in Judson ISD, as well as Churchville Universal ISD and Marion ISD. The needs of these students are identified by teachers, counselors, nurses, and social workers, presented to us, and then we have an opportunity to help them with those through financial assistance, either for healthcare-related needs like eyeglasses or hearing aids or medicines, as well as other needs they may have, clothing, shoes, school supplies, anything like that. So we're proud to be a partner in education and helping your students. Our 2017 golf tournament is scheduled for September 18th. We would like to invite you to participate. We'd like to come out and join us. I would be remiss if I was standing here to not say that Dr. Montoya, Dr. Greg Gibson, the superintendent at Churchville University, has joined our Rotary Club. I know you've been a member in the past, or a guest in the past, and we appreciate it and hope you have an opportunity to visit us soon. In addition to that, I brought about 40 heavy books with me to donate to the Judson ISD Library. So I'm going to leave them right here for now. All right, thank you very much.
Next, we have Ms. Christina Clark, Veterans Memorial High School.
Good evening, Dr. Salinas, members of the board, and Dr. Montoya. It has been an exciting inaugural school year for Veterans Memorial High School, and at this time, I would actually like to let one of our students take the podium.
Good evening. My name is Abigail Barraza, and I am a sophomore and I'm the student council president at Veterans Memorial High School. So being the first year of opening a Veterans Memorial, it has been an outstanding year. I, along with so many other students, have been involved in several sports and other extracurricular activities, including SCA and drama club. The students at Veterans Memorial have felt like patriots from the very beginning. We have all wanted to represent Patriot Nation at all games, dances, and other events. So proud to wear our patriot gear. I have many ambitious goals that I want to fulfill before I graduate, like having pep rallies at home and even more other student body activities to get everyone involved in the school, to continue growing school spirit at Veterans Memorial. I'm excited for years to come at Veterans Memorial High School and to continue building.
So as you can see, we've been patriots from the very beginning, and we're so excited to continue that tradition. We want to remind everybody that we are continuing to grow every year. We have families calling, asking about enrollment for next year, families calling from out of town, families who are moving into the area, families whose children are currently attending private school and want to come over to Veterans Memorial next year. And before you know it, in year two, we will be well over our capacity of 1,600 students. So if you've not had an opportunity to visit our amazing campus, we are going to be open this Saturday from 12 to 2 o'clock for a community open house. We invite you to come out, just take a tour, see the building. We would love to have you out there to see the great facilities that our students are enjoying. And keep in mind that early voting for the 2017 JISC bond starts on April 24th and goes through May 2nd, and Election Day is Saturday, May 6th. Thank you for your time, and remember to get out there and exercise your right to vote. Thank you.
Ms. Clark, are we having your other presenters? Ms. Torvik? Okay. Ms. Torvik, Veterans Memorial.
Good evening. I want to begin by thanking Dr. Montoya, Dr. Salinas, the prestigious board, and the audience for allowing me time to speak tonight. My name is Rachel Torvik, and I am the math department chair, inclusion algebra 1 teacher, head volleyball coach, assistant girls soccer coach, fellowship of Christian athletes, and co-National Honor Society sponsor at Veterans Memorial High School. It is a privilege that I've been given the number of leadership positions I have because it allows me to have a broader scope as to what's going on our campus. Teachers are doing more than teaching. They are creating leaders of tomorrow through extracurricular activities such as CAPE programs, fine arts, clubs, and athletics. The students are following suit by being involved in multiple activities, thereby becoming very well-rounded. A quote I've lived by this year is, a successful man is one who can lay a firm foundation with the bricks others have thrown at him. Patriot Nation has demonstrated grit when faced with adversity and found solutions. Our teachers are teaching and the kids are thriving. Throughout the leveling process and hiring of new teachers, several educators on our campus were willing to go above and beyond to provide the necessary environment for student success. An example of this was Mrs. Deer, an English teacher, found a way to create small groups with the help of others around her, both in and out of her department, and because of this, the kids were able to master the material. There is a culture of excellence as you walk through the halls and see the work posted on the teacher bulletin boards outside their rooms. The work is showing through student abilities to obtain a high level of synthesis and evaluation through combining ideas, developing opinions, judgments, and decisions. Our academic leaders are doing a phenomenal job making sure every child's education is being taken care of and that no one is falling through the cracks. Mr. Gonzalez, our TAG coordinator, spent many weeks collecting data, testing students to be able to place new kids on our TAG program. Mrs. John, our at-risk coordinator, has been an amazing liaison and mentor to our at-risk population, as well as assisting parents in finding ways to be successful with tutoring information, advisory pullouts, and goal setting. Mrs. Gonzalez, the early college advisor, has been working feverishly to ensure the success of all the students enrolled within the programs. She was instrumental in creating hand-scheduled advisory sections to help students with specific areas of need and match English and writing to successfully pass their TSI testing. Our newly formed groups of special education teachers worked diligently to make sure our students' IEP goals were met, and they also provided tutoring for at-risk students during advisory and their own conference times. Our RTI teachers are finding success within their rooms to include 65% of the RTI English Star retesters passing this last December. With more than two-thirds of our campus being freshmen, you can see the maturation of the overall student body happening overnight. The students are seeking opportunities to create clubs organize events, and find ways to leave a legacy. They are Patriot Nation, and just like the adults on our campus, they are laying a strong foundation for all other students who will follow them and walk through our doors in the future for many years to come. From school dances to hosting a field for the National Fields of Faith Rally, you can feel the excitement in the air at all times. While there is limited academic data due to our campus's youth, the most important part of education is relationships. Students don't care how much we know until they know how much we care. And Patriot Nation is developing into a tight-knit group of students, teachers, and staff that support each other in every step of the way in our pursuit and excellence in all we do.
Thank you. Mr. Mendoza.
Good evening, Dr. Montoya, Dr. Salinas, board members, and community. My name is Richard Mendoza, and I am the athletic coordinator and head football coach at Veterans Memorial High School. I'm very excited about the opportunity to communicate the progress of the Veterans Memorial High School Patriot Athletic Program, as we have been fortunate to have a great start in establishing a solid foundation in our pursuit of academic achievement and athletic excellence. Over 50% of the student body participates in our athletic program. Additionally, over a third of those student-athletes also participate in activities outside of athletics. These activities include fine arts, encompassing band, theater, orchestra, choir, and we also have several of our student-athletes that enhance their leadership skills through participation in our JROTC program. While we are still in the preliminary stages of building our program, we have been fortunate to experience many successes throughout all our athletic seasons. Our student-athletes experience success throughout our fall seasons, including volleyball, football, cross-country, tennis, swim, basketball, soccer, golf, and wrestling. Additionally, our basketball programs competed at a level that allows them to participate at the varsity level for the 2017-2018 school year, a year ahead of schedule. Our spring sports, such as softball, baseball, and track, are also representing our school district and community in a positive fashion. Our student-athletes have additionally demonstrated that academics is their priority, as over a quarter of the campus's honor roll roster are student-athletes. The Patriot Athletic Program greatly appreciates the efforts and support provided by Judson ISD to make Veterans Memorial High School an outstanding place to attain an education and participate in extracurricular activities. There is no doubt that with the continued support of our community and district leadership, Veterans Memorial High School and Patriot Athletics will be able to produce exceptional athletic programs and tremendous leaders for the immediate and distant future. Thank you again for your support and the opportunity to relay all the excellent and exciting things happening within our school and our athletic program.
Thank you. Ms. White, Vanessa White. Good evening, Dr. Montoya, Dr. Salinas, members of the board, and the community. My name is Vanessa White, and I'm the theater teacher here at Veterans Memorial High School, and I'm speaking on behalf of the Fine Arts Department. 2016-2017 school year has seen the building of multiple strong foundations of exemplary fine arts programs. The Fine Arts Department began the school year with collaboration between bands, theater, choir, dance, art, and orchestra to create a show named The Winter Extravaganza. The community came out to our auditorium to watch the wonderful display of student creativity, imagination, and execution. Art students participated in ACE this year, and many awards were given to individual students, and awards were also given to recognized students who worked collaboratively. This year's JES Fiesta Medal Design Contest was dominated by Veterans Memorial Patriots, with second place awarded to George Harris Romero and Kevin Blas winning first place, becoming the official designer of the 2016-2017 JES Fiesta Medal. Band excelled in their marching band competitions, winning first in their division, along with being the only one judge away from earning UIL sweepstakes this year. Our Winter Guard had an outstanding showing as well, qualifying for state championships. Additionally, our choir and orchestra programs had students qualify for region. Theater excelled at state UIL competition this year in theatrical design, placing second in marketing. Theater also had students win awards during the UIL one-up play.
district competition and qualifying for state UIL regional academic competition in poetry, debate, and persuasive speaking. Star Stuffers Pep Squad received several awards at the ADTS Alamo Dance Classic, including sweepstakes award, bronze for outstanding technique, and second runner-up in the Pep Squad division. Next year, the dance program will be expanding as the Liberty Bells Dance and Dance Team will be added to the dance program. We invite you to see our display at the JISD Art Extravaganza on May the 17th. Watch our collaborative production in May that involves theater, musical theater, technical theater, and dance students, and come see our spring choir showcase. Thank you so much for your continued support of Veterans Memorial and the Fine Arts Department. We're now going to move to item 6C, discussion of the fall 2016 demographic report.
Good evening, Bill President, board members, Dr. Montoya. It is my pleasure to be with you tonight. This is the results of the work that we did this past fall. And tonight, I will very briefly give you kind of the highlights. You do have a more detailed PowerPoint that was in the board book. We also have a full report that has even more information about the housing market and the neighborhood yields and the in and out transfer patterns within the district. I'll touch very briefly on the economy. The state's economy has slowed down a bit. We've seen a drop in the unemployment across the state. But the San Antonio region continues to be one of the strong performers for major cities in the country. Job growth for San Antonio is about 1.7%, and that's roughly about 18,000 to 20,000 jobs annually. Unemployment rates are also still at a very healthy level in the San Antonio region. It's the greater Houston market that has experienced the biggest slowdown, and that's related to the drop in energy related to oil prices. Home building is continuing to be very strong across the San Antonio region. The Judson ISD is ranked 5th in the San Antonio region for home construction. You're building about 750 homes a year, and you've got about 1,373 vacant developed lots that are on the ground ready for builders to build. And you've got about 5,700 futures. Those are lots that are in the preliminary stages to be developed that will be coming down the road. So you've got lots to keep you growing at a very nice rate for the foreseeable future. Here's a map of your elementary attendance zones, and this is just giving you where the most housing activity is taking place. Those red elementary zones are building more than 100 homes a year. You can see that it's the Rolling Meadows zone. They're building about 232 homes annually. And then the Masters Elementary Zone in the southern part of the district, they're building about 128 homes per year. There's plenty of lots in these areas. Here's a map that shows you where the vacant developed lots are. So there's plenty of lots in Rolling Meadows and in Masters to keep those houses going in those two elementary zones. And just some of the highlights on some of the most active developments. Cibolo Canyons, they had 32 homes under construction this past fall. Of course, Wortham Oaks, they have about 149 vacant developed lots, and they're building about 132 homes annually. That present yield, students per house, is about 0.24 students per house. You've got Summer Hill, there's 375 lots total. The groundwork is underway on the first phase. So there's a little section that is in the East Central School District, but there's about 47 lots that are within the Judson School District, and then Chandler Crossing, all 250 of those lots are in the Judson School District, and that price range is $405,000 to $525,000. So you can see this is a change in the housing market. We're seeing the prices for new homes go up quite a bit. And it's also helping your existing home values. So existing home values are also climbing up. So your appraised values are likely growing at a very healthy rate. Horizon Point, 1,415 total lots, 41 homes under construction during the fall. That price range is $150,000 to $300,000, and I would tell you most of those homes are going to be up near the $300,000 mark. It's really hard to find a brand new home that's in that $150,000. And the current yield there is 0.73 students per house. This is a more normal yield that we see in most of our subdivisions, is about 0.7 to 0.8 students per house. Woodlake Meadows, 7 homes under construction in the fall, and they anticipate building out by the end of 2017, and that's in the Hartman Elementary Zone. We are tracking some multifamily, so we had 4 multifamily projects that we're watching that were under construction. 2 of those are not tax credited, so those are market rate apartments, which means they'll have higher rent rates and have a low yield of students per house or apartment. But we do have 2 that are tax credited. The tax credited means that they'll have lower rent rates and we will likely have a higher number of students. And we can see as many as 0.8 to 1 student per unit in the tax credited apartment complexes. You can see 3 of those actually hit this fall. And then that Lookout Springs, which is under construction, 320 units, that'll hit the fall of 2017, this next year, and that's in the Rolling Meadows Elementary Attendance Zone. Charters are a big impact that we're seeing across the state. In the major cities of Texas, the charter impact is being felt in most of the districts that we work with, and that has had a big impact on the enrollment in the Jackson School District. So we do track the charters, and we definitely had an increase in students going to charters this past year. I want to get to the enrollment projections. This past year, our enrollment was 23,000. This past October, this is fall October snapshot data, we had about 23,132 students in the Jackson School District. We did have a decrease in enrollment, and as I mentioned, that was a result of students going to the charter schools. Another factor related to that was the kindergarten enrollment. You'll notice this year's kindergarten enrollment is 1,543. That's the lowest kindergarten enrollment that we've seen in the last 5 years. We have seen this phenomenon all across the country. This is not a Judson-specific issue. For the second year in a row, the state of Texas total kindergarten enrollment has decreased. The kindergarten enrollment across the state has gotten smaller. It's a result of the change in birth rates and the millennials waiting longer to marry and waiting longer to have children. So it used to be that the first year for birth for a woman was about 26. It's now gone up to 29, and so the millennials are likely a lot of those are going to be having their first child even in their 30s. So this is having an impact on kindergarten enrollment. Now, the millennials are ages, the millennial age bracket is 18 to 30. So it's a pretty big bracket. So there are some of the millennials that are starting to get into those child-producing years. We do anticipate that we're going to see a little bit of growth in the kindergarten. The next 2 years, we're still less than 1,700. But you'll notice in 2019, that's when that kindergarten number shoots back up over 1,800 in the kindergarten classes. And that's when we believe we're going to start to see those millennials start to have those children that will then start driving that kindergarten enrollment back up. Now, this is a statewide issue or a national issue. It's not just a Judson issue. Based on the number of housing that we're seeing being built in the school district, we are forecasting that within the next 5 years, enrollment is going to grow by about 1,303 students. That'll put your enrollment in 2021 at 24,435. I would say we could see some even bigger swings back positive because it's also one of the things we see when you see a charter surge, which is what you've had in the last couple of years, it's not uncommon for them to surge back. They typically will surge back after they realize that it's not that different and not any better. It's just a fad or it's a new thing. And so we're seeing this happening as well, that they can come back, and we'll see some of those surges come back after they've realized that it's not really as good as they thought. 10-year forecast is about 2,367 students of growth. That'll put your enrollment in 2026 at 25,499. At the campus level, I'll just hit some of the highlights. You remember I mentioned Rolling Meadows, and Masters. So those two elementary zones are where you're going to see the strongest elementary growth because that's where a majority of the housing is being built. Masters this past fall was 782. We've got it getting over 900 students by 2021. It'll get to 948. And by 2026, it could have over 1,200 students in the Masters Elementary School. Rolling Meadows, you can see it's growing a little faster. It could be at about 941 students next fall, and by 2026, it could also have 1,274 students. Those are the highlights at your elementary schools. At your secondary schools, you've got Kitty Hawk, which is the largest, and it's growing to about 1,500 students by 2019, and then it kind of levels off. And then we've got Metzger Middle School, which is about 938. It gets over 1,000 students by 2019. So those will be your two largest middle schools. Now, we are at the high school level. This past fall's enrollment numbers for those high schools, and you'll notice Judson High School is dropping off quite a bit. The reason it's dropping off is it's the new grades that are going to be at veterans. So as a veteran gets those grades, that's what causes Judson High School's numbers to drop off. So we did have to make some assumptions on the transfers between those two high schools. So that's where there is likely a difference from what the principal mentioned earlier to what we have is we haven't taken into consideration some of those transfer moves that may be choosing to go to veterans because of its newness and its establishing itself. So it is pretty common for these high schools that are new to kind of gain some momentum because they're new and exciting and they're creating new traditions. I'll just summarize and we'll be happy to answer some questions. Overall, the San Antonio's unemployment rate is below 4%, so we have a very healthy economy in the San Antonio region. The average home price in San Antonio is more than $205,000. It's a rise of about 15% from a year ago, so we are seeing home values climb quite a bit. Judson ISD is on pace to start more than 700 new homes in 2016, and I'll say you're probably going to be seeing about 750 to 780 in 2017. Rolling Meadows Elementary Zone has the highest rates of new home activity, accounting for nearly 40% of the new homes are being built in the Rolling Meadows Zone. And keep in mind those price ranges, price points are a little higher, so we have a little lower yield. So that's why it's growing, but based on that 200 homes a year, that price point is a lot higher than what we're seeing in the Masters Zone. Veteran Memorial High School was opened this fall. It had about 600 students, but they are adding grades, so it's going to grow very quickly. Judson ISD can expect a five-year enrollment growth of more than 1,300 students, and that will put your enrollment in 2021 at about 24,435 students. Judson ISD can expect to enroll about 25,500 students in 10 years by the 2026 school year. I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Sir, I'm sorry I didn't catch the name.
Bob Templeton.
Mr. Templeton, thank you for this presentation and the report. It's very thorough. I have a question. I'm a resident of the city of Converse.
Mm-hmm.
Converse and the city of San Antonio have entered an agreement to annex. The area that Converse is going to swap is going to make a difference in the type of homes that developers will be coming into. As a matter of fact, Gordon Hartman has committed a certain land area on 1604 that would become Converse. But at this particular time, it's not a part of Judson ISD. It's a part of, I believe, on that part of 1604 toward I-10, it's decentralized.
Yeah.
However, if Judson were to do the same thing that the cities are doing, and swap so that Jetson would become a larger area. Would there be a difference in these demographics?
Oh, there would be. There most certainly would be a difference. It does take some time to go through those swaps between school districts because the city jurisdictions is a whole separate issue from the school district boundaries. So those would be worked out with East Central, and it has to go through some...
Whatever they still got to check.
Yes, and so it takes approval from both boards, but it does have to happen.
Right, right. But that would definitely...
And it would have an impact on the projections. So we'd have to study that land and see how many housing units it can produce, and yes, it would add to it.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. Again, always enjoy your presentations. They're always very informative. And a question, you talked a little bit about the charter school impact. And so my question is, I'm looking at the geography of where some of the charter schools you traffic here. There's not very much in the northern part of the district. They're more towards the southern part. When you configure enrollment, I mean, you're talking about development. 700 more homes, I think, is what you mentioned. Is there sort of a formula that you may identify that a portion of those students won't go to Jetson ISD? They may go to a charter school based on the geography? I just try to see if you guys are looking at that too, just trying to give us an educated perspective.
We are. It's a phenomenon that's kind of reared its head in the last 4 to 5 years. And what we historically... The charters were mostly going in the areas that were economically disadvantaged, and they saw that as their niche. Now we're not seeing that solely as the case. So now the charters are popping up in different places. Unfortunately, when TEA, they say there's limited charters where there really isn't, because what they do is they just add campuses. So these charter schools just add campuses, and then they show up in old retail spots, and sometimes they're in churches, and they can show up very quickly. What we are now seeing is that there is a portion of the yield that is going. I will say we're still in the early stages of identifying what the pattern is, but right now I'd say you've probably got a number is... it's several hundred that are leaving Jetson ISD and going to the charter. So from a yield perspective, it's like a 0.1 of the 0.7, a half of a percent of the 0.7.
Well, then that was where I was going to kind of lead the question. What does the deviation look like if there's a plus or a minus? So you're saying it's 0.1 either way if we look at our demographics?
Because you're so big, you know, you've got X number of several thousand students, and then, but we do have, I'd say, 400 to 500, I'm just going off memory, that are going to charters right now. And then you've got several that are going to other school districts as well.
Certainly, and of course, we're trying to, as a Copperfield is in my district, so as I looked at the demographic of the homes being built there, some in East Central, some in Converse, we don't want to create an environment where Copperfield is overflowing, and certainly we'd like to see. So when you look at those percentages, I mean, even if we say 2% deviation just to have some wiggle room, it helps us plan and forecast when we're going to put the next bond for the next school and so forth, so that we're intelligent about that. Yep, thank you for your input.
You're welcome.
Mr. Templeton, thank you very much. I think you were here 3 years ago.
I was here. I've been here a couple of times, yes, sir.
And it's amazing that the numbers keep changing, and we are growing. I'm pretty sure Dr. Montoya will make sure that this gets to our taxpayers via the internet or the Jetson website. I think that's going to be very, very important. I'm also hoping that our district will keep track of those students that enroll telling us, oh, I'm coming from a charter school. It's going to be very interesting to find out next year, at the end of the year, how many students came from the charters Are they really meeting the targets like we're hearing? I know you said approximately 700 students. I was not aware of that number being so high. I knew we were missing some, but not that many. We're looking at 8 to 12, right?
Yes.
Okay. But anyway, thank you for the presentation. It's always excellent information to us as we make choices. Thank you, sir.
Well, thank you for allowing me to speak early in the agenda.
We are now going to convene to adjourn into closed session pursuant to the following sections of Texas Opens Meeting Acts 55.071, private consultation with the board's attorney, 551.074, discussing personnel or to hear complaints against personnel. No final action, decision, or vote shall be taken while the board is in closed session. The board shall reconvene the open meeting after the closed session, and if necessary, any vote or decision will be made in open session prior to adjourning the meeting. The time is now 7:58. Yes, we're doing personnel.